When we last talked about Annie and Billy, we said that they were competing in the market for lemonade on their street. We said that each of them decides what price to set, and consumers will then compare the two prices, and because they see the lemonade as equivalent, regardless of who's making it, they will buy from the cheapest source. Another way we can think about their competition is to say that instead of deciding what price to set, they're going to decide how much to make, how much lemonade to make. Then, depending on how much is available overall in this market, a certain price will dominate, right? Because they each want to sell all of the lemonade they've produced. And so if they've made collectively a lot of lemonade, they will be forced to charge a lower price and the other way around. So if we approach the problem this way, then what they're deciding on is the quantity. And I've put here some numbers that we can work with. So we would say that Annie can make either 15, 20, or 28 glasses of lemonade, and the same for Billy. So let's see what their payoffs would be in this case. If they each make 15 glasses, then 30 will be made total. We plug that into the demand curve, we would find that the price in the market will be 4. Well, at the price of 4, marginal cost of 1, they will each earn a profit of 3 per glass, so they will each earn $45 in profits. If Annie makes 20 glasses and Billy makes 15, then they will make 35 total. That will mean that price in the market is $3.50. So each of them has a margin of $2.50. So that means that Annie's profit will be 20 times $2.50, so $50. And Billy's will be 15 times $2.50, so 37.5. So let me fill out the rest of the payoff matrix, and then we'll look for the best responses and for any Nash equilibria that might exist in this game. Wait, let me concentrate. And now let's analyze the game and see what the best responses are for both Annie and Billy. First, if Billy were to make 15 glasses of lemonade, then Annie is best off if she makes 20 glasses, because that is the higher payoff. If Billy makes 20, then Annie is best off also making 20. If Billy makes 28, then we would compare these three payoffs for Annie, so 25.5, 24, or 11.2. And we would find that in that case, Annie is best off if she makes relatively few glasses. So we could see that she doesn't have a dominant strategy, but she does have a dominated strategy. She doesn't want to make too many glasses of lemonade, because then even though she would capture a larger portion of the total profit in the market, presumably in that case, the price would drop too much. What about Billy? Well, for Billy, we're going to look within each row. So if Annie makes 15 glasses, we'll compare these payoffs for Billy. So he's best off making 20. If she makes 20, he is also going to want to make 20. And if she makes 28, he will prefer to make 15. He also doesn't have a dominant strategy, but he does have a dominated strategy. If we had happened to pick slightly different amounts, then we might find that producing too little is dominated, so this isn't necessarily how things will always play out. So what, if any, Nash equilibria are there? Remember, a Nash equilibrium has to be an outcome where both players are best responding. Well, there's only one cell in this payoff matrix where both payoffs are circled, indicating a best response, and that's in the center. So in this game, there's only one Nash equilibrium where they each make 20 glasses and they each earn profits of 40. So this is not as good of an outcome for them as if they had produced slightly less. However, you can also see that they do still earn substantial profits. They no longer have a race to the bottom where they're decreasing their profits by trying to undercut the other, which was the outcome when we said that price is what drives competition. So that's an important difference to keep in mind. Now, when we're looking at quantity-based competition, it might also matter what order they make decisions in. Here, by putting their payoffs in a matrix form, in a payoff matrix, we're implicitly saying that they decide at the same time. What if instead, let's say Annie got a head start, so she could decide first how much lemonade to make. She opened up her stand on the street, and Billy could see exactly how much lemonade she has. Then he would be able to decide his own quantity. What would happen then? Would Billy have the advantage from being able to observe Annie before making his own decision? Let's see. If we think decisions are sequential, so they're done in turn rather than at the same time, then we're going to want to show the game not as a matrix, but as a tree, as a decision tree. So we will first say that Annie decides how many glasses to produce. And in each possible state of the world, for each possible decision she makes, we will be able to think about what Billy would do in response. What are their payoffs? Well, their payoffs will be exactly the same as from the payoff matrix. I've filled in the decision tree, so now we can go ahead and analyze it. The way we'll do that is through backward induction. So we're going to start by thinking of Billy's actions in each possible situation. The reason is because Annie will be able to predict what Billy will do in different situations. So let's say that Billy finds that Annie made 15 glasses. What will he choose to do? Well, he will compare his payoffs of 45, 50, or 47.6, and he'll decide that this is his best option, and that is to make 20 glasses. What if Annie makes 20? Then Billy will consider these payoffs, 37.5, 40, or 33.6. He'll realize that making 20 is his best option. What if Annie makes 28? Well, if Billy looks outside and sees that Annie has made a lot of lemonade, then when he compares his payoff, in either case, he will have lower profits because now the market for lemonade is overly saturated. And now his best option is actually to produce less, to make only 15 glasses. Annie knows this, so she's able to look ahead and realize that the outcomes she is actually choosing between aren't 9 outcomes, but these specific 3 outcomes. So she'll be comparing this, this, and this. Specifically, she's going to care about what her payoff is. And of course, her payoff is highest if she makes 28 glasses. So now there is again a single equilibrium outcome, but it's a different one than from the simultaneous game, right? So here they were in equivalent positions, neither had the advantage, but when Annie goes first and Billy observes what she does before he makes his decision, she will be at an advantage because she knows that Billy will be forced to respond to her action. So if she produces a lot, Billy will have no choice but to produce a small amount, and that will put her in a better position. So in this game, the first mover has the advantage, But there are also other games where decisions are made sequentially and the second mover has an advantage. It depends on the specific payoffs.